Nu har det gått för långt.
Och vem fan är du egentligen?
The law of Yalta applies to all.
I've made a lot of cheesy action shorts and whatnot since the early 2000s. But in 2018, I was ready to step up my game and collaborate with other creatives. As if it was destiny, a friend of mine told me at that time that he had acquired the rights to make a film within the Mutant universe. It just clicked. A pre-established world within an IP with a wide range of genres, all baked in one with the post-apocalyptic genre, holding it all together. I instantly agreed to be a part of it. Best of all, the project introduced me to Albin Glasell, better known as that guy who made that Black Mirror ripoff on YouTube. And together, we ventured into and out of that radioactive zone, which is working with an existing IP. We learned some stuff, so you don't have to. So gather up and stay a while. Listen closely.
What the hell are you?
Right on, Albin. Brought some grog. So, right on, we'd found a new purpose in making a movie we wanted in on. Only, the deal with the holders of the Mutant Intellectual Properties, Cabinet Group, was simply that we had permission to use the Mutant brand and not much else. We had zero backing in foreign finance or talent, so we had to use every trick in the book to make this short feel bigger than it was. Our background in independent filmmaking saw us use local locations and film them in every way possible to make it look cinematic. And most importantly, catch that mutant vibe of desolation and remnants from the time before the apocalypse. We sent a poor British person into Pripyat to shoot atmospheric transitional vistas that held the film together in the end. I filled exteriors with as many composites of structures and even a plane as I could before it felt too crowded, matching the colors and adding in some of that mighty digital smoke. In retrospect, maybe I should have asked for more external help regarding the VFX, but I did my best with the limited time frame we had at the time. Also, the barn was located just beside a heavily trafficked road, which meant all of the audio for the entire barn scene was redone in post-production. Otherwise, it would have sounded something like this.
Off the rails.
Then it came to the mutants. We knew this would be the greatest challenge for us due to budgetary restraints. We took a look at the Road to Eden video game and quickly realized that that look was simply not achievable practically with our shoestring budget. So we got a few animal masks, we modified them somewhat ourselves, out of sheer panic when we realized that none of the masks held up for close-ups or even wide shots for that matter. So my approach then became to just hide them as much as possible, often have them backlit or in the background, always in some kind of motion. To make the two bunnies somewhat believable, we tried to keep them in motion as much as possible, and I added a blinking effect with simple masking for them to move more alive. It's not much, but it makes all the difference between a blank mask and something that you can suspend your disbelief in for a moment. For the final shot of the film, our scavenger mutant hero finally reveals that he too is a mutant. But this became a bit tricky in post. The bar sign was actually there, but without the neon glow. And we used real smoke in the shot, and I had to add some digital smoke to hide that fact. As the lens shift focus, I added a gradual camera lens blur to sell the effect. Fun fact, he's actually not in focus when it stops, so I tried to make his face a little bit sharper in post. I wasn't comfortable doing the mutant transformation bit, so Albin contacted a friend to help us out. Thank you, Emil, for doing a good job. And also a huge thanks to our second unit cinematographer, Robin May, who also had some fine words to share with us today.
Hello, my name's Robin May. I'm the other director of photography on Mutant. Filming on location for Mutant was a challenge. We knew early on in the project that if we were going to recreate the world of Mutant, we needed something special. While it wasn't necessarily feasible to film the entire production in Ukraine, we knew that Chernobyl provided the backdrop that we needed. Filming in Chernobyl proved to be different to anything I had ever encountered. I worked with a local guide who helped me capture some of the scenes shown around the main film. During my time there, I had to be mindful of areas that looked safe to the human eye, but could in reality contain dangerous levels of radiation. I also had to take care to make sure that the structure that I explored were stable. Even the streets of the city were covered in dense forest, hiding manholes and dangerous pitfalls. While it was an unforgiving place to film, I feel it was exactly what the project needed in order for the audience to be fully immersed in the world of Mutant.
Mutant has a cult following, and especially in Sweden, the IP and different incarnations of it is dear to a lot of people. It released in the Dungeons & Dragons craze in the 1980s and was a smash hit. Then, throughout the years, many interpretations have been made, and it seemed to us that fans were usually sticking to one version of Mutant and claiming it to be the best. This made it tricky to create our own version of the world. The expectations would be all over the place. Would it be set in space? How much time would have passed since the apocalypse? And would it be goofy or serious? In one way, we took the safest route, and in another, the most dangerous. Depends on your point of view. What made us choose our path was determined when we simply wanted to create something from scratch. We wanted this short film to be our own creation, but still heavily influenced by all things Mutant. The plus side being that we really didn't have that many strings attached. The downside being that fans wouldn't clearly know which version of the IP this was supposed to be. And this wasn't some form of us subverting expectations. We really just thought this was the best way forward for us to have a good grip on our own story and it being able to be molded by us in the future. But we can probably all agree that the version closest to our interpretation is Mutant Year Zero, and it makes sense as that is the world me and Erik was most familiar with. We had both good understanding of those playbooks, and I had spent a lot of time in the video game adaptation Road to Eden. So, the clean slate, more minimalistic approach to Year Zero fit the bill, and off we went from there. I wrote a script with a simple plot, where the focus was on conveying the world through the atmosphere and visuals, rather than dialogue and characters. We could always flesh out the world with proper characters in a sequel. During this time, we had little to no communication with the IP holders, and at the time, this was quite liberating, as this created the sense of freedom. That part, I believe, must be somewhat unheard of when working on someone else's IP. But in the end, it might have also put us in a strange position where we had to do a lot of guesswork. Focusing on the freedom, I think we did a great job with what we had and didn't have in the financial sense, and created a short with The Road and Mad Max vibes while infusing some Mick Gordon-esque music, just like we wanted to. It could have been the start of a Swedish post-apocalyptic action series had it not been for some of our own paradoxical philosophies regarding pilots, screenwriting, and dreaded mix of business and pleasure.
So, there's a lot of talk about a sequel and continuation in this video. Should we touch on that and get it over with?
Agreed. It is actually the very core of the main conflict of this film. We hear this a lot, and the answer is yes. Our Mutant short film is both a standalone short and a pilot. But it's easier to say than to watch, if that makes sense.
Exactly. Not only that, it was also kind of a prologue to a feature film.
Yep. The first version of the feature script started with our main scavenger actually finding what he was looking for, using the map he obtained in the short. But later, that version was scrapped for a more standalone feature film.
More on that, after we figure out this whole short film pilot situation. What were we thinking?
Well, we tried, foolishly or ambitiously, to strike a balance between a piece which anyone, anywhere, could just jump into and enjoy, fan or not. But also a film for the fans, with stuff only they could pick up on, such as the Mimir connection in the end. That would point to this actually being a prologue, or more specifically a pilot, for what was to come. The problem with this is that we really can't have the cake and eat it, right? So for a lot of people, this totally backfired on us, where they didn't get all the nods to the IP's universe, or that it didn't have enough of lore and iconography from the books and games.
It was a fatal split, sort of painting ourselves into a corner. We wanted to be both, and it just doesn't seem to be possible in a universally accepted way. So, semi-pro tip, pick one, not both. Either make it completely standalone or a pilot. Let's finish this with Mutant as a pilot then. And for the finished script, for the feature film, what happened?
It only ever got to a full first draft, and that's the sad part. It would be a continuation of our world of Mutant, and our scavenger would play a crucial role, but he wasn't the protagonist. It was a slow burn ensemble piece which escalated from Mad Max action to Predator horror with a splash of zombie survival in the end, heavily inspired by the Musmusel module for the original Mutant game released in 1984.
And?
Well, here's another tip. Never show the first draft to a studio or producers. Just don't. It's the bare bones version, and it seems like it scared away our chance of making this with an idea we all thought could be a really cool film, especially unique for the Swedish film landscape.
With that said, the feature film is technically in a limbo, as the last thing we heard from the studios, Cabinet Group, and Pathfinder was that they still wanted to pursue this feature with us at the helm.
We've been there with Netflix in the past, and that have taught us to simply move on. And that's another tip for you filmmakers. Don't wait for them to come to you. Keep moving forward.
That's how winning is done!
And what a great segue into our final segment. Cheers!
Did we gain any considerable insight in making Mutant and working with an IP and all of the back and forth with the studios? Could we give some hard-earned but digestible wisdom to other filmmakers in our shoes?
I think so. Point is, we had a really fun time playing around with an IP, which in the end we didn't have any control over. Meaning, it was a good time. We learned a lot, but it didn't make us into known filmmakers, especially as we didn't get to make that feature film sequel. There's no point in bitching about the what-ifs. We're quite glad for the experience in hindsight, because it was the final push that made us understand the one truth for filmmakers such as us. Filmmakers who keep making films, no matter what.
Don't cater to the studios and never make your films for the attention. Just do whatever you like to do, and eventually you will find your audience with your artistic integrity intact. Relax, take your time to figure it out, and never seek approval. Approve yourself. Trust your process. You know it best.
Right on. And if you failed, you fail at your own terms, which is a success and a failure at the same time. Twice the fun. I guess we just got caught up in this whole potential Netflix thing, as we really want to do this for a living, so we didn't see things clearly at the time.
Film is weird, because it's both business and pleasure. Sometimes more business, sometimes more pleasure. But our conclusion in filmmaking comes down to this every day now since Mutant and its twisted post-launch limbo. Film whatever makes you happy.
Now we're creatively at a better place where we focus on making things we want to make, which is right on.
And there's more to come.
So stay tuned as we leave Mutant and the studio system behind us and venture into our very own original filmmaking territory.
Thank you for watching.
Fantastic.
What the hell are you?
You son of a bitch.